for those who know NATO, my counterpart is General Jürgen Bornemann. He's the Director General of NATO's International Military Staff. We almost weekly coordinate.
But there's also a big difference. Besides what we both do is our direct support to the military committee. So I'm head of the staff, basically supporting the 27 EU chiefs of defense, and he does the same for the 28 at NATO side. My boss, since last year January, is Cathy Ashton, the head of the External Action Service. So the military staff moved within the External Action Service, which makes, and we not mention her Minister of Foreign Affairs and Defense, but if you look at her tasks, she looks a bit like the Minister of Foreign Affairs and Defense, and by the way, often also development. She is the one, like a Minister of Foreign Affairs mostly is expected to do, to coordinate all external action. And of course, there are other commissioners within the EU who think they have to coordinate their own external actions, so it's a normal tension. But the difference is, I am part of her organization. And I must say, though I'm not saying that in every country then we should do the same, in, at this international level, if I compare it with NATO, I can really be very enthusiastic about the strength of the EU being the comprehensive approach. You will hear that word much more often. And I heard, and what I hear much more often, yes, but the United States is much more comprehensive than the EU. Yes, because you have one government and they sit around the table. And you have all those domains, and every country has the possibility to be comprehensive. But if you compare NATO and the EU, what I now find excellent within the EU, though I'm not saying it's easy, that as the military, we are now part from the beginning of strategic thinking with all the different players around the table. If there is a crisis, and I already can give you many examples, I won't do so because it's focused on capabilities, but if there is a crisis, I'm called around the table under Cathy Ashton or Secretary General V. Moore, who spoke just before. And there I talk with the person who directs all the embassies in the region, or the people who can block bank accounts, block visa, give development aid with a budget of 11 billion, etc. So both strategic thinking from the beginning is more comprehensive, but also thinking on what instruments to use and how to synchronize that from the beginning. That absolutely is the strength. And this is my first job within the EU. All my other jobs were within coalitions of the willing or in central command or in NATO. For the first time, I see that from the beginning, all those basically ministries and representatives of ministries sit around the table. And then you get, like we had in Ivory Coast, the benefit of that someone can organize how to block bank accounts. So the military were not paid anymore for Gbagbo, and then military becomes much easier to do something about it. Well, why do I say this? Because if we talk about capability development, and the reason I say I am not duplicating what NATO is doing, if it is about conceptual development, which is also capabilities, standardization, doctrine, concepts, terminology, etc., etc. We not duplicate anything of that. We just use it, because all our forces, whether they are NATO members or PFP countries, they completely work based on NATO standards, which are developed within NATO, which then makes NATO completely, of course, interoperable with all their member states, but because the US is such an important player within NATO, it makes me even compatible if I want to cooperate with New Zealand, Australia, or many, many other countries we work with. So that's one part. Another question, if it is about capabilities, and I'm not saying what we are now developing, and this afternoon Mrs. Claude France Arnoux will talk also. So she certainly will also talk about what EDA is doing. I more want to concentrate on the question, why are we developing military capabilities? And then I, amongst others, come also to this European security strategy, which has already been mentioned this morning, but also the Lisbon Treaty and the Council conclusion implementing it. There it is clear what is the aim of having also the military within the EU. And it links to the strength of that comprehensive approach, but also the military ambition is just lower than in NATO. It starts with humanitarian assistance, SSR, DDR, but stabilization, also peacekeeping, and peace enforcing or peacemaking. So I'm not saying we're only soft. In those soft domains, by the way, comprehensiveness with all the civilian actors like development aid, etc., are sometimes easier to find. But in our ambition is certainly also that if it goes wrong in the direct environment of Europe again, and for instance, NATO would not be willing to act, or maybe it's absolutely unreasonable that that we expect that the US would come to our rescue and take the bulk of the cost, which had to happen often, that we at least have the capability to solve in our own direct region local conflicts. And the ambition goes up to 60,000. Now here we have a problem. If you ask me, are you really able to do so? The answer is no. And we prove it over and over again. Because also even within NATO, if the US would not have taken part in Libya, for instance, which, if you look at it, was a great effort, but at the same time, it was a limited conflict. 8 million people, quite old conventional troops, etc., and it, we had a hard time to solve it. So if we, within the European Union, start to develop capabilities, use our budgets more efficiently, because basically that's what it is about for a large part, it is not in competition with NATO, it is not in competition with US, but we are strengthening a capability and we are then able to work together, and we will use our strength and you will use your strength. And common defense will always remain with NATO, and that is essential, like also the standardization of our troops, we will not duplicate. Now, what are the military capabilities of the EU? Basically only my staff, but compared to almost 1,000 of NATO with my staff of 200, and below is nothing. Where NATO now is reducing from 12,500 to 7,500, I have mobilizable headquarters, and we augmented with people, with officers and staff, if we want to do something, like we did, by the way, several times. So it works. It's a very cheap way to organize yourself. But it is not the fastest way to organize yourself. But Atalanta is done from Northwood in the UK very efficiently with an EU headquarters, which has been augmented when we started to use it. We used the OHQ, which is an empty building in Paris, augmented it and did the operation in Chad. And we also have the possibility to use NATO capabilities under the Berlin Plus arrangement, like we do in Bosnia-Herzegovina. But it might be politically quite difficult to do that again. Another topic is pooling and sharing. I'd like to mention it, though I'm sure Mrs. Claude France Arnoux will come back to it this afternoon, but because the European Defence Agency is basically the most important organization coordinating this within the EU. And it is almost the same as smart defense, which I'm not going to say anything about because Admiral Pottinger will certainly do so. But basically, it is that we facilitate member states to create their capabilities more efficiently. And we have so many gaps in our military capabilities that the only way to get them is to do it together. But what is very important to understand is we are not creating EU capabilities. As far as possible, we facilitate member states to create member states' capabilities. So that is not in competition with anyone. It's what we often use as an example is the Strategic Air Command in Hungary. That was a NATO initiative, but we also have two EU initiatives which look like it, and that's the European Air Traffic Command and EATF, where basically the idea is member states buy together, maintain together a capability, but each individual member state decides on how it can be used. So they buy basically flyer hours if it is Strategic Air Command. And many of us are just not able, not have enough budget to buy those capabilities and sustain those capabilities ourselves. So if we do it together, we at least can get it. And then the member states can still decide whether they use it under the EU or the NATO or under NATO, UN coalitions of the willing, etc. So that are more now the messages I want to give about the why. Why is it useful that the EU is having this military dimension, both partly because also the US will expect us to solve several crises ourselves or take the bulk of the burden. At the same time, we are also creating bigger capabilities, but they can be used in whatever coalition. So we become also as Europe a more important partner for the US. And at the end, we always have the same political goals in many crises, so that only will strengthen our common position. I'd like to leave it up to them. Thank you.